As you start to make a change in your teaching to one that allows more student thinking, you quickly notice that your math resources don't really change with you. And most people don't have the time or money to get new math materials. I'm Christina Tondevold, the Recovering Traditionalist, and today we're going to take a look at adapting math resources to encourage student thinking in our quest to build our math minds so we can build the math minds of our students. Now, as I said, when you start to change your teaching to be more of the style that is student-centered by allowing kids to solve problems in ways that make sense to them, share their thinking about strategies, you quickly start to see that most math materials aren't really helping you out. The materials are very focused on having kids solve problems one particular way. But you don't have to completely throw out these materials. I've got 4 suggestions for you on how you can adapt your math resources to encourage more student thinking. And they all start with a C. So let's call this the 4, and that was totally a backward C, wasn't it? This way. All right. They all start with a C. So let's call this the 4 C's to adapting your math resources. All right. Number 1 is connect to prior knowledge. Our first C is connect. One of the things that I feel like textbooks do is that they want kids to just learn one specific way to solve a problem. And they do it like they want to teach kids this certain way to solve it. And they do it because they feel like kids don't really have the prior knowledge needed to be able to solve the problem on their own. This also happens at home. I know I would have been this kind of parent, so I'm not faulting anyone because we're just trying to help our kids. But when our kids come home with homework and they aren't sure how to solve it, like they're just stuck. They're like, I don't know what to do on this. As a parent, we just want to say, well, do it this way. Do it the way that I learned, which was, for most of us, the traditional algorithm kind of way. So we kind of force our kids to solve it the one way we know instead of doing it their own way because they're kind of stuck like, I don't even have a way. So we kind of revert to the way that we were taught. So one of the ways to allow more student thinking is to connect a current problem with something that they have learned in the past. So a quick way you can do this is to do a number string or take whatever is in your textbook or a worksheet and just attach a helper problem. If you've ever done number strings, you know what I'm talking about. But a helper problem is basically you give them an easier problem or a problem that they've done in the past to help them connect the two together. So if you're doing multi-digit addition, you could start with single-digit addition and have the kids solve like 9 plus 7 and then move into 49 plus 37. So the 9 plus 7 would be the helper problem. I saw this just the other day with my son. He had been gone because he was sick. And in the homework, one of the problem sets was something similar to this. This wasn't exactly it, but this idea was in there. It showed 41 minus 20. And then the next problem was something like 41 minus 19. Now, as a second grade kid, there's probably some kiddos in that classroom that if the problem was just 41 minus 19 on the worksheet, they might be stuck. They might not know where to start. And as a parent, most parents would be like, well, I'm just going to teach you the algorithm. But because it started with a helper problem of 41 minus 20, the kids might be more likely to see how 41 minus 20 connects to 41 minus 90. And the parents might too, or whoever is at home helping them, when they see the 41 minus 20 and then 41 minus 19, it might trigger in them also to encourage their student or child, whoever, whatever relation it is to them, encourage the student to take a look at the relationship instead of just moving towards solve it this way, the way that I learned how to solve it. So again, our first C was make connections. Connect to something that they know to help them with something they don't know. All right, number 2 is catch the mistake. So textbooks will often give kids a bunch of different ways to solve problems. Like, we're going to learn this way, and then this way, and then this way. And all it does is basically confuse a whole lot of kids. And it frustrates parents as well to be like, why do we need to have five different ways to solve an addition problem? Just teach them one way. And the textbooks are well-meaning, like they want kids to develop different ways to solve problems, but it comes across as learning five different procedures when one might work. So the idea of this is to allow kids to solve problems any way that they want, but sometimes our textbooks will say, nope, you've got to solve it this way, this way. And so instead of that, instead of saying you have to solve it this way, one of the ways I like to do it is to do four problems completely solved out for the kids, however you want to do it. But in one of the problems, you've made a mistake. And so they're going to go through and solve each one of those problems, trying to figure out which one's got the mistake, where the mistake is, right? And so it's some great way to practice problems without kids having to solve it a particular way. It's already solved for them, but it is bringing out their thinking process. You get to see how the kid approached the problems, to see how they figured out where the mistake was, and it gives you a lot more insight into how they're thinking about problems, okay? Okay, so our third C is convince me. So a lot of textbooks and worksheets that you find out there will have just a series of problems, right? It'll give them the problems and it'll put equals whatever, right? So my adaptation is just put in answers, even incorrect answers. You want some that are correct answers, some that are incorrect answers, and it's not the job of the student to go through and solve them because there's already answers there. It is for the students to go through and convince you whether that answer is true or false. Is it the correct answer or was it a wrong answer? And they can prove that any way that they want. Right? You've already put the answers in there. So let's say the problem on the worksheet was 45 plus 37. You could put the correct answer in there, but a very common incorrect answer, and anytime I try to put one that is wrong, I try to think of what is a common mistake that kids would make. So a common mistake is that kids will add the tens together, the 4 and the 3, the 40 and the 30, and say 70, and then the 5 and the 7 to make 12, but they just do the 7 and the 2, and they'll make 72. So I would put 45 plus 37, and I would write the answer as 72. And then the job for the students is to go through and convince me that that is correct, or convince me that it's wrong, any way that you want, right? And it allows, again, your students' thinking to come out. And still use the resource of your textbook. Just go ahead and give them some answers, and then they have to prove whether it's true or false. All right, my last adaptation is cut out. Mm-hmm. Because most of the resources we have way too many things for the kids to do. Whether it's your textbook, whether it's a worksheet, whatever it is, there are typically way too many problems. And that, just by the nature of seeing it, kids start to think, well, I don't have time to really work through this. I need to just give an answer because I've got all of these problems to do. I don't have time to show my thinking on every single one of them. So time becomes that pressure for them because they feel like they need to solve all of these. But also, the room that we give kids to solve it. Like, we give kids these worksheets and they have just a little tiny space to, and it's basically just asking for an answer. So take any worksheet that you have, your textbook thing that you have that you're giving the kids, whether it is from the textbook or whatever, have the kids do every other problem. If it's a worksheet, just take some paper and cover up every other problem, then make a copy of it before you give it to the kiddos. Just allowing that more space on the page frees up their time because they aren't feeling the pressure of there's so many I have to get done, but it also gives them the space to show their thinking. And that is such an important feeling for kids to be able to look at that and feel like, I've got room to actually show my teacher my thinking process. So as you work to provide your students different types of experiences, ones that are more student-centered, You don't need to completely throw out the resources you have. You don't have to be spending time on the internet searching on Teachers Pay Teachers and Pinterest and Google trying to find things. Use the resources you have, but use those four C's to help you adapt those math resources to allow time for students to think through problems and solve the problems in their own way. All right, I hope this video has helped you build your math mind so you can go build the math minds of your students. Have a great day.